The celebrant for this ordination mass is the Most Reverend Joseph Perry, Auxiliary Bishop of Chicago. And those being ordained are Reverend Mr. Thu Truong from Nashville, Tennessee, Reverend Mr. John Audino from Clifton Park, New York, Reverend Mr. Joseph Dalimata from Coram, Montana, Reverend Nicholas Eichman from Fort Wayne, Indiana, and his brother, Reverend Mr. James Eichman from Fort Wayne, Indiana. The bishop and servers begin the prayers at the foot of the altar. To God who giveth joy to my youth. Judge me, O God, and distinguish my cause from the nation that is not holy. Deliver me from the unjust and deceitful man. For thou, O God, art my strength. Why hast thou cast me off? And why go I sorrowful whilst the enemy afflicteth me? Send forth thy light and thy truth. They have conducted me and brought me unto thy holy mountain and into thy tabernacles. And I will go unto the altar of God to God who giveth joy to my youth. To thee, O God, my God, I will give praise upon the harp. Why art thou sad in my soul, and why dost thou disquiet me? Hope in God, for I will still give praise to him, the salvation of my countenance and my God.
Thank you.
The bishop ascends the altar and he reverences it with the kiss before he incenses the altar. Just as the priests in the Old Testament, given by God to Moses on Mount Sinai, the priests, before they enter the Holy of Holies, fills the sanctuary with holy incense when he enters the presence of God. Meanwhile, the choir sings the introit. Let my mouth be filled with thy praise, alleluia, that I may sing, alleluia. My lips shall rejoice when I shall sing to thee, alleluia, alleluia. In thee, O Lord, have I hoped. Let me never be put to confusion. Deliver me in thy justice and rescue me. Bishop begins to process to his throne, or to the sedilia. And as the priest, the bishop, the priest par excellence represents Christ in his diocese, the Mass follows him to his throne. So that's where he'll say some of the prayers of the Mass, the propers of the Mass, and some of the readings. During this time, the bishop is reading the introit as well as the Kyrie eleison. silence, and the bishop stands and begins with the collect, addressing the people, Pax Vobis, sending the Holy Spirit down upon them. And with this prayer, the collect of the church, the bride of Christ, petitions her bride Christ to her, petitions Christ her husband for a particular intention. Today we read, grant to thy church, we beseech thee, O merciful God, that being gathered in the Holy Spirit, it may be nowise molested by any assault of the enemy, through our Lord Jesus Christ, thy Son, who lives and reigns with thee in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, world without end. Amen. The epistle is then sung by the subdeacon. This was taken from that of Joel. Thus saith the Lord God, O children of Zion, rejoice, and be joyful in the Lord your God, because he hath given you a teacher of justice, and he will make the earthly and the latter rain to come down to you, as in the beginning, and the floors shall be filled with wheat, and the presses shall overflow with wine and oil, and you shall eat in plenty, and shall be filled, and you shall praise the name of the Lord your God, who hath done wonders with you, that and my people shall not be confounded forever, and you shall know that I am in the midst of Israel, and I am the Lord your God, and there is none besides, and my people shall not be confounded forever, said the Lord Almighty. The choir then sings the sequence, the sequence that is the same throughout the octave of Pentecost. Holy Spirit, Lord of light, from thy clear celestial height, thy pure beaming radiance give. Come, thou Father of the poor, come with treasures which endure. Come, thou light of all that live. Thou of all consolers best, thou the soul's delightsome guest, dost refreshing peace bestow. Thou in toil art comfort sweet, pleasant coolness in the heat, solace in the midst of woe. Light immortal, light divine, visit thou these hearts of thine, and our inmost being fill. If thou take thy grace away, nothing pure in man will stay. All his good is turned to ill. Heal our wounds, our strength renew. On our dryness pour thy dew. Wash the stains of guilt away. Bend the stubborn heart and will, melt the frozen, warm the chill, guide the steps that go astray. Thou on those who evermore thee confess and thee adore, in thy sevenfold gifts descend. Give them comfort when they die, give them life on thee on high, with thee on high, give them joys that never end. Amen.
Greetings to one and all, with special mention, Father Joseph Bizig, members of the faculty and administration of Our Lady of Guadalupe Seminary, parents and relatives and friends of the Ordinands, their classmates, benefactors, and well-wishers. It is my honor to be with you to celebrate this milestone for the church and the community that is the priestly fraternity of St. Peter. Father Joseph Bizig asked me to remind you of a serious piece of information before we begin, and that is that the members of the community are dispensed from the obligation of the hours, supplanting the hours, of course, are sacred rites today for the ordination to presbyterate, and the various other prayers and sundry intercessions and indications for those who are to be anointed in the name of Christ's priesthood, for which we ask everyone's prayers today. This day, following years of study and preparation and evaluation by those responsible, we raise to the dignity of the holy priesthood of these deacons for whom you have kept vigil with your academic and spiritual instruction, your prayers, and your affection. Today is Friday within the octave of Pentecost. We are still this week basking in the glory and the energizing fire of new vistas in faith and witness and hope prompted by the Paschal mystery. Pentecost was actually a Jewish feast called Shavuot in Hebrew that happened to be celebrated in Jerusalem on the very day of this coming of the Holy Spirit. Jews had come from everywhere for the feast, and the scriptures use this Jewish festival in order to instruct us, the church, emerging from the Jewish Jesus. Jerusalem, being a cosmopolitan city and mercantile center of its time, there were also a lot of other people of a variety of backgrounds milling around, non-Jews, gathered there that day as the Acts of the Apostles describes. Jewish Pentecost commemorates the day God gave the Torah, that portion of the Hebrew scriptures referred to as the law, to the Israelites at Mount Sinai. It was in the receiving the law that Israel became a nation upon receiving these superior instructions from God. Hence, what is often described by Christian theologians as the bridge from the Old Testament to the New Testament was effected that day, as Israel became a nation through receiving the law. We became the church through reception of God's Holy Spirit. Approximate to his ascension back to the Father, Jesus urged his friends to stay in Jerusalem and await the gift of God. He promised this to his followers. Notice Jesus does not allow the disciples to linger after they have recognized who he really is, days after his resurrection. He immediately moves from wishing peace to commissioning them for purposes of witness. And this commissioning involves his sending his disciples just as God sent Jesus. This sending is about doing the work that Jesus did while on earth. This work was primarily revealing God's presence in the words and the deeds of Jesus. This commissioning is divinely sanctioned by Jesus breathing the Holy Spirit upon his disciples. Included in this mission is the power to forgive and to retain sin. Sin is the failure to recognize the revelation of God in Jesus. Hence, the inauguration of the Christian dispensation. The total self-emptying of Jesus Christ in his suffering and death inspires in us an insatiable thirst for that joy that can be found, we believe, in a relationship with Jesus Christ. We know that nothing else satisfies. The Lord Jesus instructs his priests to supply for you the nourishment you need to stay focused upon him through means of the gospel and the sacraments, the fonts for meeting Christ. Only by looking again at the perfect and fascinating humanity of Jesus, alive and active still today, bending down to each one of us, can we let him illumine our lives and fill the abyss of need found in our humanity. Today, therefore, the Church gives us new priests to carry forth his divine will on our behalf. We surround these men with our love and support while we witness them offer the sacrifice of Christ and feed us with the Lord's body and blood while awaiting the Lord's return for us. Pentecost reminds us that priesthood is situated in the Church from its beginnings. After the Lord's death and reports of his resurrection, the minds of the disciples were taxed under the strain of waiting. It proved a growing perplexity that Jesus was not with them any longer. Some of them had seen the risen Jesus beyond their words to explain it. Yet they were still puzzled in wake of recent horrible events. They had been given audacious promises by him. They had been called to high service for him in the world. Yet as the days marched on, nothing was happening. They had every right to be angry about Jesus' false conviction and torturous murder. It was categorically unethical, immoral, and unjust. However, when faced with the choice of perpetuating the cycle of divisiveness and violence through revenge, the Holy Spirit stirred them to be instead messengers of Christ's peace. A peace the world does not know, as Jesus described it. A peace we can best describe as an inward and genuinely felt calm, relished in mind and heart, that he so wanted his disciples to have and to own amidst the turmoil of a violent world. Following his resurrection, each time he visited his friends without knocking on the door, he wished them this peace. This peace that Jesus wished upon them, upon us, is much, much more than what the world implies by common parlance. Amidst their anguished waiting, suddenly on this particular Jewish festival, where people were assembled in Jerusalem from every which way for the commemoration of the giving of the law of God, something truly remarkably happened. The gift of God suddenly came. There was a noise like that of a strong driving wind, tornado-like. There was the appearance of tongues like flames of fire dispersed and resting on each one present. It was such an enormous event as to produce sounds and sights and actions of a highly ecstatic nature. There appeared this bursting, cataclysmic manifestation of the Holy Spirit. The gift of God Jesus talked about had arrived. On that Pentecost, the disciples had come out from a back room in the corner of the city and were found preaching aloud the powerful story of the Christ. It proved a transformed Pentecost, very much so. Now, amongst those coming towards them amidst all the commotion were found people with different shaped noses, different colored eyes, different tongues of speech, and different hues of skin. And collectively, they realized they were all about the same thing, the same truth, inspired by the one Jesus story. In that spirit, this diverse group of people is described, some several thousand, as reported by the scripture today, gathered around the disciples to embark on a new life-giving adventure of faith and hope and promise. The priesthood given to the apostles at his supper is suddenly empowered by the Holy Spirit and launched out into the world to anoint the world with the person of our Lord and Master. It is this same Holy Spirit we summon today in the rite of sacred ordination. I wager none of this was happening by coincidence. In retrospect, it was all choreographed by the God of salvation himself. The crowd gathered that day, a mix of Jews and Gentiles, fellow countrymen and foreigners, all of them summoned by God to the Christ event. Conversion numbers that day were astounding, considering numbers we are familiar with today. The church has tried to hold on to Pentecost and that event ever since. There are times when we discern the Holy Spirit's presence to be definite and eloquent and breathtaking. At other times, situations seem akin to our hiding in Jerusalem, waiting for the Holy Spirit to cut through the intransigence and the weakness of the moment. The community of church is born, an unforeseen mosaic of ethnicities and cultures and backgrounds. Anytime people refuse to acknowledge their kinship under the Lordship of God, their efforts of communication fail, as in the case of the Tower of Babel narrative in the Genesis account. Total misunderstanding. On the other hand, where people come toward one another as Christ modeled for us, living and loving under the Lordship of God, marvelous communication is the result. There, people not only hear each other, but they can even hear the Word of God through each other. It shows what the Spirit's work shall be henceforth, namely, bringing all people to a unity of understanding in Jesus Christ. This is one of the works of the priesthood in the world today, a world unfortunately torn asunder by ignorance, misunderstanding, nationalist feeling, bias, fear and suspicion, and segregation. Priests today are called to reverse the confusion of Babel and its grip on our lives. Like those first Christians at the first Pentecost, we each have new and distinct gifts to communicate God's love to everyone we meet along the journey of life. Priests are called to summon everyone in the variety of our humanity to the embrace of the Christ who is the cause of our peace and a world like ours, where harshness rules the day. Like those first Christians, our ancestors, we live in uncertain times. For sure, Pentecost is much more than a crafted celebration of color and jubilation. It arrives each spring as a new creation, heralding an extraordinary season laden with gifts, challenge, and God-given purpose. We are coached this day to believe that we can create more light for our darkness, more courage for our fears, more hope for our cynicism and despair, more wisdom for our confusion, more love for our hate, and more peace for our turmoil. This day, friends, we Christians are nudged to believe that together we are more, but are nothing much at all when we are alone, relishing our private space. Along the course of life's journeys, we have all discovered that the world is fractured, that the pieces don't quite fit, and some pieces seem to be missing, and the parts do not always equal the whole. It isn't that the world is merely cockeyed. There is a deep wound in this world through which the blood of Christ still flows. It isn't just that there are floods and hurricanes and earthquakes and tornadoes, ravaging sickness and death. There is also purposeful sin found in the world. That sin is found in each of us, and that sin reveals itself in a myriad of denials, small and large, and perhaps more than just three times found in us, to echo the Apostle Peter that fateful night. The Lord has forgiven us, yes, in his death and resurrection. And in midst of our misery, Jesus often appears without knocking on the door. When all efforts seem fruitless and burdens and mistakes of the past linger to haunt us. For all the terror and inhumanity that still disfigures the human family and that tends to depress our spirits, be assured that the Holy Spirit is active and will see goodness triumph over evil. Know, too, that God uses us to accomplish his goodness in the world. Communication in the human village can be frustrating, as you know, but Pentecost teaches us that the law of Jesus Christ, his law of love, is the basis for our mutual understanding. Our ability to find unity comes from our shared gift of this Holy Spirit. All of us have the breath of God in us. Sometimes we forget this. Yet God's love, God's spirit, God's breath restores life again and again despite us. Hopefully, we live our lives with a desire to keep this Holy Spirit with us. Hopefully, a tongue of fire rests on each of us, teaching us how to be God's children, keenly aware of our shared kinship in Christ. For this work of forming church among us, the Holy Priesthood asks for a man totally in love with God and harboring empathy with people, willing to give up anything for the welfare of the church. While we priests bear the limitations and weakness that befall all men, it is our love and our penance that redeems us and raises us to character befitting responsibilities incident to service of God's people. We know we are unworthy for this charge. The Lord and Master's drawing out of us depths of sacrificial love and devotion raises us to new heights we otherwise never would have imagined for ourselves. Brothers, come to be ordained today. Your love of God and your loyalty to the church is very evident. The ministerial priesthood demands a special kind of love by which a priest endeavors to give his entire life for the salvation of others. For this reason, we applaud you. We see in you signs of Jesus' promise that we will receive in the next life, 100-fold, having given up everything to follow the Master himself. Be mindful, therefore, of the dignity attached to your consecration. Holy Church has approved you for ordination in the rank of presbyters. Anticipating your ministry beyond today, let me reference the words of one of the church fathers, Gregory Nazianzus, in his collection of Orationes, where he says, every priest must rediscover the absolute need for personal sanctity. Before purifying others, you must purify yourself. To instruct others, you must be instructed. For priests must become light in order to illuminate and become close to God, in order to bring others closer to him. They have to be sanctified in order to sanctify. Thus, as you have been faithful to Christ, dear brothers, along your journey, Christ will remain faithful to you. Christ, to whose priesthood you will be configured, remains absolutely loyal to the covenant he makes with each priest. It's expected that you return this loyalty to Christ by making a permanent covenant promise to serve God and his church with all your heart, all your mind, and your every energy. Rich and abundant are the graces of priestly ordination to help you keep this commitment. The Holy Spirit offers you an ocean of strength to accomplish this pastoral mission. Give your priestly vocation, therefore, the totality of your love and every ounce of your fidelity. As an alter Christus, lift up and ennoble the common priesthood of the faithful, enabling us to worship in truth, to speak the truth, perform deeds of truth, and thus reach the heights of holiness as the people of God we are called to be. May the good God who has begun all of these good things in you bring it all to fulfillment on the day of the Lord, which is coming.
During the ordination ceremony, we have the actual ordinations taking place between the sermon and the gospel. The sermon takes place, which you have just heard, before the gospel. So the bishop will process to the center and call the men forward.
Reverendissimo San Cristo Patra Dominus, Dominus Iosifus Dei, et Apostolicis Heres Gratia Episcopos Auxiliaris Cica Gianti, sub excommunicationis pene precipi emandat omnibus, et singulus pro suspiendis ordinibus vic presentibus, nec quis forsan eorum iver dilatis et alias et iure, vel ab omine excommunicatus interdictus, suspensus spurius and clemens, ad alias iure prohibitus, sibi ex alieni diotensi oriundus, sibi licentius sui episcopi, el non descriptus examinatus approbatus, et nominatus ulla patu audia necessibiendus ordines ex cereri, et qua nullus ex ordinatus discenda, nisi misa finita,
before the assistant priest calls the men forward, he first issues an admonition, warning them that if there be any irregularity in their state of life, if they're not going to take this life seriously, then to take this next step forward with severity, with pureness of heart.
Nicholas Eichman, Fort Wayne, Indiana. James Eichman, Fort Wayne, Indiana.
This admonition, or this calling the men forward, represents the vocation as they're called by name to serve before the altar of God. What comes next is the bishop addressing those to be ordained. He says, in Latin, "Dearly beloved brethren, as all on a ship, both the captain and the passengers have the same reasons for confidence or for fear. They should act together with one mind, seeing that their interests are the same. The fathers therefore decreed with reason that the people should be consulted in the election of those who are to minister at the altar. Even should their life and conduct be unknown to the greater number, they may be known to some, and all will necessarily yield a more ready obedience to a priest to whose ordination they have signified their assent. Now the conduct of these deacons, whom by God's help we are about to ordain priests, is, as far as we can tell, exemplary, pleasing to God, and deserving, in our opinion, of a higher ecclesiastical dignity. But as the judgment of one person, or even of several, may be affected and misled by favor or partiality, it is well to ascertain the general opinion. Wherefore, set forth freely what you may know of the actions or behavior of these men, and what you think of their worth, and testify to their fitness for the priesthood on account of their deserts, rather than from any partiality to them. If then anyone has aught to their prejudice, for God's sake and in God's name, let him boldly come forward and speak. Nevertheless, let him be mindful of his own condition." The bishop then addresses them with the words, Dearly beloved sons, as you are now about to be consecrated to the office of the priesthood, endeavor to receive it worthily, and when you have received it, fulfill its duties blamelessly. The priest is ordained to offer sacrifice, to bless, guide, preach, and baptize. With great awe, then, should one advance to so high a state, and care must be taken that they who are chosen to be commended for their heavenly wisdom, their blameless life, and their persevering practice of virtue. Thus, when the Lord commanded Moses to choose 70 men of all Israel to be his helpers, to whom he would impart the gifts of the Holy Ghost, he added, whom thou knowest to be the elders of the people, you indeed foreshadowed by these 70 men and elders, if through the sevenfold Spirit you keep the Ten Commandments of the law and show yourselves blameless and mature, both in your knowledge and in your work, the same mystical meaning and the same type are found in the New Testament when the Lord chose the 72 and sent them forth in pairs to preach before him, thus teaching both by word and deed that the ministers of his church should be perfect in faith and action, that is, well grounded in the virtue of the twofold love of God and neighbor. Strive then to be such as may rightly be chosen by God's grace to assist Moses and the 12 apostles, that is, the Catholic bishops, who are represented by Moses and the apostles. For indeed, Holy Church is served, adorned, and governed by an admirable variety of ministers. First the bishops, under them the priests, then the deacons and the subdeacons, each consecrated in their own degree, and all these members, though differing in dignity, forming one body of Christ. Wherefore, dearly beloved sons, whom the voice of our brethren has chosen, that you may be consecrated as our helpers, let your conduct at all times be the outcome of a chaste and holy life. Consider what you do, imitate that which you handle, and as you celebrate the mysteries of the Lord's death, be earnest in ridding your members by mortification of all vices and lusts. Let your teaching be a spiritual remedy for God's people. Let the fragrance of your lives be a delight to the Church of God, that by both your preaching and example you may build up the house, that is, the family of God, so that neither we may deserve to be condemned by the Lord for promoting you to so sublime an office, nor you for taking it upon yourselves, but rather that he may reward us all. May he of his grace grant us this. Amen.
Quod ipse nobis concedat per gratiam suam. Amen.
What follows next will be the Litany of the Saints. The Ordinandi will prostrate themselves before the altar, and the Church, the Bride of Christ, will invoke God, Mother Mary, and all the saints in heaven to pray for these men as they take this step. So I'd encourage you during this time to ask the saints of God, ask our Heavenly Father, ask our Mother Mary to be with these five men, that as they receive the Holy Spirit and the sacred orders, that they would be effective lights to the Church.
Quod hos electus benedicere et dignamis.
Deo caus salimos.
Quod hos electus benedicere et sanctificare et dignamis.
Deo caus salimos.
Quod hos electus benedicere et sanctificare et consecrare et dignamis.
The ordinands will now process before the bishop, where he will silently pray over them and place his hands upon their head. This constitutes the matter of the sacrament. And when they get back to their spots, kneeling before him, he will say to them, "Dearly beloved brethren, let us implore God, the Father Almighty, to increase his heavenly gifts in these his servants, whom he has chosen for the office of the priesthood, that by his help they may attain to what they now undertake through his gracious call, through Christ our Lord. Amen." And all of the priests in attendance will do likewise, placing their hands over those ordained, thus giving their assent as well to the actions that are taking place and promising them their prayers for them in the future.
Thank you.
Oremus fratres solicibi. Oremus fratres solicibi Deum Patrem omnipotente, ut super os famus suos quos et presbyterium unus elegi, celeste donem utricite, et reius dignatio lucisitio, ipsius consequantur auxilium, per Christum Dominum nostrum.
Amen.
Oremus.
Lectamus genua.
Le patres. Exaudius vagius dominus deus noster, et super hospitalis suus benedictionem sanctus spiritus, et gratiis sacerdotalis infunde virtutem, ut quos qui pietatis expectibus efferimus consecramus, de perpon unidus qui longitate consecramus, de Domum nostrum Deum Christum Filium Tuum, qui et vivere regnatum in usum Spiritus Sancti Verbum, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
The bishop is saying the preface, which in it contains the form of the sacrament of holy orders. He says it is truly right and just, fitting and profitable, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to Thee, Holy Lord, Father Almighty, Everlasting God, the fountain of all honors and the bestower of every dignity, by whom all things make progress, by whom all things are strengthened, in accord with whose wise plan thy rational creatures are gradually drawn to a higher excellence. Thus the priestly grade and the office of the Levites, types of what was to follow, were fraught with a fuller significance, when to the high priest first chosen by thee to govern thy people, thou didst give men of lesser degree and of subordinate rank as their associates and helpers. Thus in the wilderness didst thou infuse the spirit of Moses into the minds of the 70 wise men, whose help enabled him to govern without difficulty the countless multitude of thy people. Thus, too, didst thou pour into Eleazar and Ithamar, the sons of Aaron, the superabundant graces bestowed on their father, that the number of priests might be found sufficient for the more frequent celebration of the sacrifices and other sacred rites. In the same manner, O Lord, didst thou associate with the apostles of thy Son other teachers of the faith by whom their words were spread throughout the whole world. Wherefore, we beseech thee, O Lord, bestow the like help on our weakness, who need it the more as our frailty is so much the greater. Then extending both of his hands over the ordinance, the bishop pronounces the actual form of the sacrament. Grant, we beseech thee, Almighty Father, to these thy servants the dignity of the priesthood. Renew within them the spirit of holiness, that they may keep the rank in thy service, which they have received from thee, and by their conduct may afford a pattern of holy living.
In varie discere di Signore Spiritus Sanctus, or acceptum a te, Deus, secundi meriti nun sottilia, censurantur in morum exemplus sui conversationis sincera. Si provita, cuperatoris ordinis nostris, enunciare neis socis formae justitiae, ut bonum rationem dispensialus si, credite veritur, eterne beatitudinis premi consequentur. Spiritus Sanctus.
The ordinands now process before the bishop, where he places the stole on them in the priestly fashion, crossing it in the center, and he says, "Take thou the yoke of the Lord, for his yoke is sweet and his burden is light." Then he places on them the chasuble and says, "Take thou the priestly vestment whereby charity is signified, for God is well able to give thee an increase of charity and its perfect works."
Thank you.
chasuble remains folded in the back, a symbol of the power of the confession, which is, or the power to absolve sins, which is a bound power, which you will release at the end of Mass. Bishop now stands and he'll say, he'll bless the new ordinate or the ordinance with the prayer. O God, the source of all holiness, of whom are the our true consecration and the fullness of blessing pour down, O Lord, on these thy servants, whom we now call to the honor of the priesthood, the grace of thy blessing, that by the gravity of their actions and the example of their lives, they may show themselves to be elders formed by the rule that Paul gave to Titus and Timothy, that meditating on thy law day and night, they may believe what they read, teach what they believe, conform to what they teach, giving proof in themselves and setting an example of justice, steadfastness, mercy, fortitude, as well as all the other virtues, and by their admonition confirm others in the same, keeping the gift of their ministry pure and undefiled. May their holy blessing change for the service of thy people bread and wine into the body and blood of thy Son, and having attained through persevering charity unto mature manhood, and in old age receive the fullness of Christ, may they rise again on the day of the just and everlasting judgment of God with a good conscience, faith unfeigned, and imbued with the Holy Ghost, through the same Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the unity of the Holy Ghost, God, world without end. Amen.
Era io il nome nostro Gesù Cristo, figlio del cuore. Tu sei contigo le regolate di ricapo e di Spirito Santo, Dio. Romi asse, tu l'asse, tu l'uomo. Amen.
Returning to the altar, the bishop will intone the Veni Creator Spiritus, invoking the Holy Spirit to come down upon these newly ordained priests.
Veni Creator Spiritus.
Process up before the bishop, and he consecrates their hands with the oil of catechumens and wraps them in a white linen called a maniturgia. And he says, "Be pleased, O Lord, to consecrate and hallow these hands by this anointing and our blessing. Amen." Over the hands of each other and says that whatsoever they bless may be blessed, and whatsoever they consecrate may be consecrated and hallowed in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Celebrate Mass, both for the living and the dead, in the name of the Lord. Amen. Sacrifice to God in the name of Christ, and it's through these prayers, through these blessings that are given to the bishop, and he passes them down to the priest, that he is able to offer these offer the holy sacrifice of the Mass. power of Christ came through the apostles on down to Bishop Perry here, and he is bestowing that priestly power to offer sacrifice in Christ's name to these five men.
Satano per il sacrificio in Deo, il sacro celebrare, santo vivis, santo refugio, in nome di Domino. Amen. Accipe per il Satano per il sacrificio in Deo, il sacro celebrare, santo vivis, santo refugio, in nome di Domino.
The newly ordained have their hands unbound over by the credence table, where they also wash their hands and process back to their pew with the lighted candle in their hand. the bishop processes back to his throne in preparation for the Holy Gospel. Receive a blessing by the bishop before he reads it for all. Thank you. For the gospel is sung, the deacon first incenses the gospels before he sings it. Those words and actions of Christ, which are so sacred, they can only be sung. A continuation of the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke. At that time it came to pass on a certain day that Jesus sat teaching, and there were Pharisees and doctors of the law sitting by, that were come out of every town of Galilee and Judea and Jerusalem, and the power of the Lord was to heal them. And behold, a man brought in a bed a man who had the palsy, and they sought means to bring him in, and to lay him before him. And when they could not find by what way they might bring him in, because of the multitude, they went up upon the roof, and let him down through the tiles with his bed into the midst before Jesus. And when he saw their faith, he said, Man, thy sins are forgiven thee. And the scribes and Pharisees began to think, saying, Who is this who speaketh blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God alone? And when Jesus knew their thoughts, answering, he saith to them, What is it you think in your hearts? Which is easier to say, Thy sins are forgiven thee, or to say, Arise and walk? But that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins, I say to thee, Arise, take up thy bed, and go into thy house. And immediately rising up before them, he took up the bed on which he lay, and he went away to his own house, glorifying God. And all were astonished, and they glorified God, and they were filled with fear, saying, We have seen wonderful things today.
Thank you.
the creed being finished, the bishop turns and says, Dominus Vobiscum, the Lord be with you and with thy spirit. The offertory prayer is what follows, which reads as follows. Praise the Lord, O my soul, in my life I will praise the Lord. I will sing to my God as long as I shall be. Alleluia. The bishop then sits and with a gremial placed over his lap, he'll receive the candles which the newly ordained processed in with. The candle which is symbolic of the candle they received at their baptism, which at that moment they were asked to lead a life, a blameless life, a life where they're representing Christ, where they're living the virtues. They're called to be a light in the world. And by offering the candles today, by processing in with these candles, they are basically saying that they have kept the faith since their baptism, and they are offering their light to Christ now, to his church, in his service. That light which gives light to the world as it's slowly being consumed is a beautiful example of the Christian life. The servers set out in the sanctuary a little book stand along with a pillow as the newly ordained priest will concelebrate this Mass, the Mass of his ordination. In the traditional rite, it'll be the only Mass that he concelebrates, but he invites an assistant priest to help him follow along during the Mass as he follows it with the bishop. Canon of the Mass, which is usually said mostly in silence, will be said aloud by the bishop so that the newly ordained can follow along. The chalice is brought up by the subdeacon wearing the humeral veil on your right. As the bishop offers the host up to God,
Anche immacolata hostia, omega wingdings, formulus tuus, offered o tigo del meo, vivo del.
prohibitabilibus peccatus et offensionibus, et negligentiis meis et pro omnibus circumstantibus, sed pro omnibus fidelibus Christianis vivis atque defunctus, ut mihi, ut ilius proficier ad salutem in vitam aeternam.
The paten on which the host rests is offered to God, but the paten symbolizes the glory of Christ. As the bishop offers it, he will place the host down on the corporal and give the paten to the subdeacon, where the subdeacon will wear it or will hold it veiled at the foot of the altar. The water and wine having been offered, the bishop will then load the thurible with incense and incense the gifts as well as the altar. The bishop is incensed by the deacon with his mitre on. And then comes the lavabo where he washes his hands. And he says, I will wash my hands among the innocent, and I will compass thine altar, O Lord, that I may hear the voice of praise and tell of all thy wondrous works. I have loved, O Lord, the beauty of thy house and the place where thy glory dwelleth. Take not away my soul, O God, with the wicked, nor my life with bloodthirsty men, in whose hands are iniquities. Their right hand is filled with gifts, but I have walked in my innocence. Redeem me and have mercy on me. My foot has stood in the direct way. In the churches I will bless thee, O Lord.
Salutare, nos tibi semper erbique, gratia sagere. Domine sancte pater omnipotens, eterne Deus, per Christum Dominum nostrum, qui ascendens super omnes celos, sedensque ad dexteram tua, promissum spiritum sancte hodierna die, in filios od apsio onis effudit. Qua propter tuo fusis gaudis, totus in obe terrarum mundus exultat. Sed et superner virtutes, aqui angelice potestates, hymnum gloriae tube concinut, sine fine dicentes.
Sanctus, sanctus, sanctus,
that bell marks the Hankijitur. We're approaching the consecration of the body, blood, soul, and divinity of Christ in the bread and the wine.
Thank you.
veniat regnum tuum, fiat voluntas tua, sicut in cielo et in terra. Panem nostrum quotidianum da nobis hodie, et dimitte nobis debita nostra, sicut et nos dimittimus debitoribus nostris, et ne nos inducas in tentationem.
The Our Father being completed, the subdeacon returns the paten up to the bishop, where it is reunited under the host, which is now the body, blood, soul, and divinity of Jesus.
Beatis Apostolis tuis Petrus et Paulo, per Andrea et omnibus sanctis, da propitius pacem in diebus nostris, per opere misericordiae tui adiuti, per apicamus simul semper liberi, per ab omni perturbatione securi. Pere unum Dominum nostrum, Iesum Christum filium tuum, qui tecum vivere regnat in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, et omnia saecula saeculorum. Pax Domini sit semper vobiscum. Comitio et consecratio corporis et sanguinis Domini nostri Iesu Christi, fiat recipientibus nobis in vitam eternam. Amen. Agnus Dei, qui tollis peccata mundi, miserere nobis. Agnus Dei, qui tollis peccata mundi, miserere nobis. Agnus Dei, qui tollis peccata mundi, dona nobis pace.
After the bishop says, Lamb of God, take us away the sins of the world, grant us peace, he then says a prayer that was where he says, Lord Jesus Christ, who did say to thine apostles, peace I leave you, my peace I give unto you, regard not my sins, but the faith of thy church, and grant her that peace and unity which is agreeable to thy will, who livest and reignest, God, world without end. Amen. He then kisses the altar and gives the kiss of peace to the ministers. And the ministers, in turn, give that peace, the kiss of peace, to the other clergies present.
Jesu Christi, Filii Dei vivi, qui ex patri voluntate patris cooperante Spiritus Sancto, per mortem tuam mundum vivificaste, libera me per hoc sacrosanctum corpus et sanguinem tuum, ab omnibus iniquitatibus meis, per universis malis,
et fac me tui semper inherere mandatis, rate limpum separare permitas, quicum eorum Deo Patri et Spiritus Sancto vivis regnas Deus in saecula saeculorum. Amen. Perceptio corporis tui Domini Iesu Christi, ut ego indignus sumeri praesumo non mihi poveriet in judicium et condemnationem, sed pro tua pietati prosit mihi ab tutamentum mentis et corporis, et ab merelem percipienda, qui vivis et regnas cum Deo Patri in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum. Panem celestem accipiam, et nomen Domini invocabam. Domini non sum dignus ad intercepte meam, se tandem dic verbo et sinabitur anima mea. Domini non sum dignus ad intercepte.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should come under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Domini non sum dignus ad intercepte meam, se tandem dic verbo et sinabitur anima mea. Corpus Domini nostri Iesu Christi, custodi l'anima mea, in vita eterna. Amen.
The bishop then receives Holy Communion. The deacon and subdeacons step away as the bishop consumes the chalice, the precious blood. And after he consumes the host and the precious blood, it is seen as the consummation of the sacrifice. The newly ordained will now also consume the host, will receive Holy Communion. At this, their first priestly mass.
Sanctus Apostolus Petrus Paolo, omnibus sanctis et tibi pater, quia peccavi nimis cogitatione verbo et opere, mea culpa, mea maxima culpa. Id io preco Beata Mariam semper virginem, beata Michaelem Arcangelum, beata Ioanna Baptistam, Sanctus Apostolus Petrum et Paulum, omnes sanctus et te pater, orare per mea Dominum Deum nostrum.
Miserereato vestri omnipotens Deus, et de missis vicatis vestris, spiritu quod vos vitam eternam.
Amen.
indulgentiam,
the deacon absolution,
and receives absolution.
As traditionally, this is a rite of absolution before receiving Holy Communion.
Ecce Agnus Dei, ecce quitolet peccata mundi.
The bishop holds up the host over the ciborium and says the words, Ecce Agnus Dei, behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. For those of you who are not able to join us in person and receive Holy Communion, we'd invite you to receive a spiritual communion today. During this time where everybody's receiving Holy Communion, invite our Lord into your hearts. Ask him to fill you up with his graces and to bless these young men who have just taken that step forward, that they may persevere in the graces which they have received today unto the end. For those wishing to make a spiritual communion, my Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come, at least spiritually, into my heart. I embrace you as if I were already there and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen. the communion antiphon. I will not leave you orphans. I will come to you again. Alleluia. And your heart shall rejoice. Alleluia. The bishop intoned the Yam Nam Dikam. No longer will I call you servants, but my friends, because you have known all things I have wrought in the midst of you. Alleluia. Receive the Holy Ghost, the Comforter within you. He it is whom the Father will send to you. Alleluia. Ye are my friends if ye do the things that I command you. Receive the Holy Ghost, the Comforter within you. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost. He it is whom the Father will send to you. Alleluia. These words spoken by our Lord at the Last Supper indicating the close bond of the priest with the priest par excellence, Christ himself. Of the newly ordained, and says the words, "Receive the Holy Ghost. Whose sins you shall forgive, they are forgiven them, and whose sins you shall retain, they are retained." And the chasuble is let down. And the bishop says, "The Lord clothe thee with the robe of innocence." Once the newly ordained has had his chasuble let down, he gets back in line where the bishop will take his hands within his own and says, "Dost thou promise to thy prelate, thy ordinary, reverence and obedience?" And the newly ordained says, "I promise." He promises obedience to his superiors, no matter what diocese he's in. The bishop then admonishes the newly ordained with these words, "Dearly beloved son, as that which you will now have to do is not free from risk, I warn you that before you attempt to celebrate the Mass, you diligently learn from the experienced priests the ceremonies of the whole Mass, and all that regards the consecration and breaking of the host and the communion." And he gives them his blessing, saying, "May the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost descend upon you, that you may be blessed in the priestly order and may offer propitiatory sacrifices for the sins and offenses of the people of Almighty God, to whom belongs glory and honor, world without end. Amen."
ambus relinquam orphanos, veniam ad vos iterum, alleluia, et gaudebit cor vestrum, alleluia.
Dominus vobiscum.
Noremus, sumsimus domine sacri dona mysterii, humiliter deprecantis sunt, quae in tu commemorationem nos facere rei precepisti, in nostre proficiant infirmitatis auxilio. Quos tuis domine deficis sacramentis, continuis atole benignus auxilis, ut tue redemptionis effectum, et mysteris capiamus et mortibus, qui vivis et regnas cum Deo Patrum unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
We have received, O Lord, thy sacred and mysterious gifts, humbly imploring that what thou hast taught us to do in commemoration of thee may profit for the help of our infirmity, who livest and reignest, God, world without end. Amen. Mercifully lift up thy abiding hope those whom thou dost refresh by thy sacraments, so that we may receive the fruit of thy redemption, both in these mysteries and in the conduct of our lives, who livest and reignest, God, world without end. Amen. How he prepares to give them his final blessing and admonition. He says, dearly beloved sons, consider attentively the order you have taken and the burden laid on your shoulders. Endeavor to lead a holy and godly life and to please Almighty God, that you may obtain his grace, which may he of his mercy be pleased to grant you. You that have been ordained priest, after your first mass, say three other masses, namely one of the Holy Ghost, a second of the Blessed Virgin Mary, and a third for the faithful departed, and pray also to Almighty God for me.
Et omnipotentem Deum etiam cum erat.
Libente.
Dominus vobiscum.
The bishop now prepares to say the last gospel. This is the beginning of the Gospel of John, said as a way of thanksgiving at the end of Mass. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was made nothing that has been made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. When a light shines in the darkness, and the darkness grasped it not. There was a man, one sent from God, whose name was John. This man came as a witness to bear witness concerning the light, that all might believe through him. He was not himself the light, but was to bear witness to the light. It was the true light that enlightens every man who comes into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world knew him not. He came into his own, and his own received him not. But to as many as received him, he gave the power to become the children of God, to those who believe in his name, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we saw his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Thanks be to God. Bishop will now descend, and before departing, intone the Te Deum Laudamus, which is a prayer of thanksgiving to God for all of his graces on this most special day, his day privileged to these five men, but to the whole church as well.